quick tips to guarantee that you are always motivated, no matter what, for the rest of your life. And by that, I guess what I really mean is, I'm going to talk a little bit about the intersection between motivation and personality type, and hopefully I have something helpful to say. Only you can decide that, so come along. Alright, so before I dive in, I just want to thank you guys for showing up and for watching this video. And I especially want to thank my subscribers, those who have been here for forever, and those who are actively clicking the subscribe button right now. You know who you are. Thank you. Alright, so motivation and personality type. How can we connect these two concepts? I guess I personally want to get started just by offering some loose definitions of terms. So for me, I think of a personality type in a very Jungian way. There are definitely other ways to conceptualize personality. You could think of Big Five and factor analysis. You could look at some really weird Freudian fixation concepts, but for me, it's all Jungian, baby. And what that means is I think about personality as a hierarchy of bipolar preferences. If you know the MBTI very well, you know that you can be either an introvert or an extrovert, an intuitive or a sensor, a thinker or a feeler, a perceiver or a judger. That's a very basic way of looking at things, but it at least conveys the fundamental idea that I want to get at of these binary preferences. In my opinion, the objective personality system is the most robust incarnation available of a Jungian approach, and in that system, there are many more binaries for people to play with as tools of self-understanding. But regardless, that's how I think about personality. It's a hierarchy of binary preferences. As for motivation, I mean, obviously we all know what motivation is, but for the sake of completion, I'll give a definition. I like to think of motivation as merely the ability to consciously channel and direct your energy slash attention. When I was a college student, I was a philosophy major, and in my final semester as a philosophy major, I had to write an enormous capstone paper. The final paper ended up being, I think, just under 30 pages, and your boy did not actually start on his final paper until the night before it was due. Luckily for me, I've got some pretty wicked words per minute in these fingertips, and I have let's just say I have an ability to BS with the best of them. I honestly think the only reason that I survived that night was a 2 liter of Mountain Dew and a massive pizza, which we called the Grizzly. I think it had like a 30-inch diameter. Anyway, you could look at that particular situation where I am guzzling down Mountain Dew and wolfing down pizza and hammering away at my keyboard as a motivationally challenged situation, to say the least. My ideal self would have paid good money for me to be able to redirect my attention and my focus and be able to work on that paper in the weeks preceding the due date. Anyway, story time over. Basically, we have two working definitions of motivation and personality type. Now, you might assume that certain personality types are going to struggle with motivation more than other types. For example, in the conventional MBTI, if we look at the perceiving slash judging dichotomy, people who are judgers are assumed to be very organized, very efficient, structured in their approach to things. And if I look back at that situation from my own life, I can see that what I needed was more structure. So maybe you could assume that judgers are more easily motivated or more readily able to redirect their motivation. And then if you look at the objective personality system, you might assume that people who are play above sleep are somehow more motivated. And that's because people who have a preference for sleep, they tend to preserve and conserve their energy for the sake of the self. They don't do a lot of expending. They don't do a lot of pinballing with the tribe. So we have this picture of somebody who is very reluctant to expend any energy. And it's not hard to see why you might think that's somehow connected to motivation. The same goes for blast above consume. People who prefer consume really take their time to get started. They like to acquire information from multiple sources, and they never feel like they have enough information to then have permission to start acting on that information, whereas people who prefer blast above consume, well, they can take in just the slightest shred of information and think, all right, I'm good to go. I can take this and I can just apply this principle again and again. And so with blasters, you have this tight association with that more conventional idea of a judger in the MBTI system. At least that's how I currently think about these differing systems and how the terms somewhat overlap. Anyway, my point is, it's understandable why you might think that motivation comes more easily for certain types as opposed to others. However, I don't think that's quite right. I personally would argue that every personality type and every binary preference comes with its own motivational trade-off. So you might be motivated to do a particular kind of work or engage in a particular kind of activity, but you're doing so at the expense of that activity's opposite. In my eyes, there's this radical relativity and radical symmetry between all of these different binary preferences. So no particular form of motivation that's associated with these preferences is going to be more valuable than any other. But the issue is, we live in a culture, we live in a particular moment in history, and what differentiates one culture from another is that certain modes of being are more valued, are more prioritized. And so, despite that more fundamental relativity of preferences, you'll see cultures sort of encouraging one preference as opposed to the other. And then, in a very fractal sense, where the microcosm is reflecting the macrocosm, the individual psyche also exhibits preferences. So we can all access the full gamut of cognitive functions, but we also inherently prefer one end of a pole to the other end of the pole. And this is a bit of a tangent, but it actually makes me wonder if, in some sense, it's actually easier to be an introvert. And I know that goes counter to all of the conventional wisdom, but please hear me out. What I